Today we are going to discuss a very important part in biophysics or introduction physiology. It's called hemodynamics. I mean by this term, hemo means blood, dynamics means flow. You know that blood is flowing in a constant velocity if you are normal. So we are going to discuss physical laws governing blood. But before discussing these laws, at first you should look to this slide. This red cylinder represents blood vessel. Blood vessel has got beginning and end. The blood should flow from high pressure at the beginning to low pressure at the end. So this cylinder is normal. In order the flow to occur, which is represented by this blue arrow, the beginning should have narrowing. If it is narrowed, so the blood will press laterally on the wall, causing high pressure here compared to the end. So flow occurs according to pressure gradient. And this is very important to know. First information you should know, flow is direct proportional with pressure gradient. And this means that if pressure gradient increases, flow will increase. There is direct relationship. Look with me to this slide. Here is the narrowing at the beginning. Blood flow, represented by this blue arrow, it faces a resistance at the start, and this resistance will make high pressure here. So high pressure here compared with the diameter at the end. Look, here is wide and here is narrow. And as a general information, any wide vessel has got low pressure. There is no lateral pressing on the wall, and vice versa if the vessel is narrowed. And this will lead us to a very important conclusion. If you have a high resistance here, flow will decrease. And I mean by this resistance at this narrow area. But afterwards, the flow will occur. So this means that there is inverse relationship between flow and resistance. And this inverse relationship will help us to know Ohm's law, the final law. We have two information: flow direct proportional with pressure gradient, and flow inversely proportional with resistance. This is the final law, F equal delta P over R. R capital is the abbreviation of the word resistance. Your question to me now, doctor, what is the benefit to know Ohm's law? Does this have an application in our body? Yes, it has an application. We will compare now two important circulation: pulmonary circulation, which is the lesser circulation, from right ventricle pump the blood to pulmonary artery, then to the lung. This is a very short circulation. It will be compared with a longer circulation called systemic circulation. I mean by systemic, left ventricle pumps the blood to aorta, then to arteriole, which is a small artery, then to the capillaries, venules, veins, then back to the right atrium. You know this information from basic science while you were in primary school. So now we are going to know the difference between pressure gradient in pulmonary and systemic circulation. I want all of you to imagine which will be greater. To be logic, pressure gradient, if increases, flow increases. I need this for longer distance or for a short distance. What's your opinion? You would say for longer distance. I want to flow to all tissues. All tissues should take flow at the same time, but with different percentage according to the importance and needs of each tissue. So systemic circulation should be high pressure gradient, but we want to prove this with numerical values, not only logically. So look at first to this drawing. This is the heart, right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, left ventricle. Right ventricle pumps the blood into pulmonary artery, this arch called the pulmonary artery, then to the lung to be oxygenated. All of you know that pulmonary artery is the only artery which carries deoxygenated blood. It will be oxygenated in the lung, then it will return to pulmonary veins, to left atrium. So the start will be where? Imagine. I want you to know pressure gradient depend on start and end. Start will be pulmonary artery. It is called after this artery, pulmonary circulation. So the start will be pulmonary artery. The end will be the left atrium. So we want to know the pressure in each one of them to know the gradient. Pulmonary artery, its mean or average pressure equal 15, and the pressure in the left atrium equal 0. So 15 minus 0. Yes, start minus end. But before we go to systemic circulation, you want to know that pressure gradient in pulmonary circulation equal 15 minus 0 equal 15 millimeter mercury. I want you to remember this pressure gradient. To, according to systemic circulation, start will be in the aorta to artery. Look to these circles, six circles represent what will happen. And I put number in front, above each circle to know the journey of systemic circulation from where it start and where it will be ended. It start from the aorta, artery, big arteries, small arteries, to arteriole, to capillaries, veins. The end will be right atrium. Start at number one. The average aortic pressure equal 93 millimeter mercury, and you will know how this value is obtained. But in order to be easier for you at the start, we will say that average aortic pressure equal 90 millimeter mercury. It's not totally accurate. The end will be right atrium, 0 millimeter mercury. I want you to know that 0 doesn't mean that there is no blood flow. There is blood flow, but atrium has the ability to expand. It is a volume reservoir. So when blood presses laterally on the wall of right atrium is like a balloon. It will distend. So pressure inside equal 0. This is very important to know. So start 90 and 0. So pressure gradient equal 90 millimeter mercury. Do you remember pressure gradient in pulmonary circulation? You will say equal 15 millimeter mercury. So pressure gradient in systemic equal 6 times that of pulmonary circulation, which means that flow will be more in this circulation. This is very important, and I ask the question, what is the importance? Look please to Ohm's law. If pressure gradient increases, represented by upward red arrow, flow will increase. And flow increases to pump blood to all tissues. I want to know the wisdom of God. God wants the logic to occur according to your body needs. And this is proved mathematically by numerical values. But before we move to another topic, I want you to know that the resistance in systemic circulation is more. Doctor, why? Systemic circulation has got arterioles. Arterioles have smooth muscles in its wall. And if these smooth muscles in the two walls approximate to each other, like is shown by my hands in the video, this means that resistance increases. And if they move away from each other, the vessel will be widened and resistance decreases. So arterioles are called stopcock. It's like a sphincter which control the volume of flow which moves to capillaries. And this seems to be very logic. Capillary main function is exchange with tissues. Capillaries give tissues oxygen and take carbon dioxide from it. Exchange occurs according to the metabolic activity of tissues. Suppose the tissues now are not active. So what will happen? Capillaries should receive less flow. And this occurs by arteriolar vasoconstriction. Arteriole is the door in front of capillaries. If it closes, capillaries will not receive blood. And this which you want to happen, we want to receive less blood now to have less gas exchange. And this is very, very important. You should know. And vice versa, if tissues are metabolically active. So this is a very important character of arteriole. They are resistant vessels. And you can ask me a question now. Doctor, is this vessel the only one which have this criteria? My answer is yes. It is the only vessel. It's called stopcock or resistant vessels. But aorta has got a very important function, which is called elasticity. You know, like a balloon. A balloon has elastic fibers, which allow it to expand or to be narrowed. So this elasticity allows the aorta to accommodate blood from the left ventricle during systole. And also, this property helps the aorta to be narrowed in order to increase the pressure inside to make flow occurs from aorta to any other vessel in our body to help the tissues to get enough blood flow. So this is called elastic recoil. Yes, elastic recoil. And aorta has an important function. It is called pressure reservoir, which means it will store a certain volume of blood in its wall. It will not distribute the whole blood to tissues. When the left ventricle pumps blood into the aorta, aorta is so intelligent. It knows that the left ventricle will relax to be filled with blood, so no blood will move from left ventricle to aorta. So aorta stores the blood in its wall by potential energy to be converted into kinetic energy. And this kinetic or dynamic function, which we are discussing today, hemodynamics. This is very important. You should know. Look to the arteriole. Here is the smooth muscle in the wall. It is like a snake. This smooth muscle can be closer together or away from each other. What about veins? Veins are characterized by compliance or distensibility. You know, distension is a scientific term you took in school while you were younger. But today you are in medicine. You should know the other scientific term, compliance. And I will ask you a question now. If I say this balloon, for example, has high distensibility, you can answer me by what? How it is highly distensible? You'll say, doctor, it is filled with large volume of air with less pressure on its wall. The same will be discussed by veins. Veins have the ability to accommodate large volume of blood with little pressure on its wall. And I will tell you a very important percentage. Veins accommodate 54% of blood in your circulation with little pressure on its wall. This is very important. And we can discuss how the equation of compliance is obtained. At first, delta volume is direct proportional by delta pressure. And this needs explanation. You'll ask me, doctor, how this occur? I want you to concentrate now with me. Any vessel, if distended, volume inside increases. But you will say, but pressure at the same time will decrease. Vessel is wide. But at the end, this accommodation of extra volume of blood will press on the wall. So pressure increases at the end. So pressure decreases at the beginning, but increases after accommodation occurs, after blood is stabilized inside. So if we are discussing the end, this is the first information. So I want you to make an equation. In our primary school, our teachers let us know that direct proportional will be equal times constant. So delta volume equal delta pressure times constant. This constant is called compliance, and the compliance equal delta V over delta P. Accommodation of large volume of blood with little pressure. So if volume increases, the constant is compliance increases, and vice versa. If pressure increases from the beginning, this means that you cannot accommodate more and more volume, so your distensibility will decrease. So there is an inverse relationship between compliance and pressure gradient. This will lead us to a very important question, and this question will be discussed in the next video. What are factors affecting resistance? You'll tell me pressure gradient flow only according to Ohm's law. But I will add another law in the next video. According to the French scientist Poisier law. So the next video we are going to discuss factors affecting resistance, and we are going also to discuss types of flow, how flow moves, straight lines, or it will make a noise by pressing on the wall. And we will discuss how to differentiate between two types of flow according to the French scientist Reynolds number.